With Raksha, a session on Garbha Samskara, antenatal care and postnatal care. It is organized by Ayurveda Map and supported by Relax Kerala. So just, I would like to brief about the topics on Raksha, that is the Garbha Samskara and its practical applications in the present scenario, month-wise fetal development and Masanuvasika Kalpanas, management of minor ailments in pregnancies, management of complicated pregnancies, management of miscarriages or abortions, examination with investigation in pregnancies, postnatal care and common practices in different parts of Kerala, the postnatal care, the common practices in the North India, music therapy in antenatal and postnatal periods, common Aushadha yogas indicated and contraindicated in Prasuti Tantra, the common breast-related issues during the postnatal period, the do's and don'ts in neonatal care and management of common pediatric diseases under 1 year, the management of postnatal blues and depression, application of panchakarma in antenatal and postnatal periods, yoga protocols in pregnancy, the diet in antenatal and postnatal period. So these are the topics that will be dealt in Raksha, and we have all eminent faculties for our sessions. And the key points about the session is that we have 25 plus hours, that is 16 sessions. We have lifetime access to the recorded classes. We have a knowledge about the understanding and importance of Garbha Samskara, antenatal and postnatal care, that is exclusively through Ayurveda. And we get imbibing confidence in clinical practices. And we have 12 brainstorming sessions. So now, today, we are here for the introductory session to the Raksha series, and it will be conducted by Dr. Divya Srinath. We are very familiar with Dr. Divya Srinath, as she was a part of our Pushya session. So just briefing about her, she is a specialist consultant at Dr. Divya's Ayurveda Gynecology and Fertility Speciality Clinic, Trivandrum, Kerala. She is a visiting faculty at Del Rosario University, Bogota, Colombia. She is also a visiting consultant at Sri Rudra Multispeciality Hospital and Research Center, Alappuzha. Also at Sridhariam Hospital, Trivandrum. She worked as a former research fellow in Project Diminishing Ovarian Reserve. And she, of course, is a topper in final PG studies. And she had done a number of publications, almost around 10 research publications in different national and international journals. So I warmly invite Dr. Divya Srinath for this session. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Dr. Radhika, for such a nice introduction. And I would also like to take this opportunity to thank Dr. Jasul, founder of Ayurveda Map, for giving me such a nice opportunity. Dr. Radhika, is my screen visible?
Yes, ma'am. Your screen is visible now.
A very good evening to one and all. This session, this introduction to Raksha, this session is mainly intended to refresh what we had learned in our final year in Prasuti Tantra, especially in Prasuti Tantra, so that it will be easier for us to understand the concept of Raksha. I hope this session and the Raksha session will definitely help you in your clinical practice. So let's start from the preconceptional care. Okay, so as you all know that every parent desires of a healthy progeny. In our classics also, we can see so many references like Veeryavandam Sudam Sude, Shreyasi Praja, Chirayushin, Rubavandam, Gunavandam, so many we can see references for getting a healthy progeny. Certain ways and methods are also mentioned for getting a healthy progeny. For that, a planned pregnancy is always better than an unplanned pregnancy. The reason behind is that if a lady come to you with a UPT positive, that is a urine pregnancy test positive, or with a serum beta HCG value positive or more than 50, or even some patients may come to you with a initial USG. So when their patient approaches you, the organogenesis has already started. That is, organogenesis start from third week to eighth week is the period that is organogenesis, and this period is more vulnerable to any external environmental changes, or that is external factor which can harm the health of the baby. So there lies the importance of preconceptional care. Recently, there are so many researches are being done on this area, especially on this preconceptional health. So the recent study says that this unappreciated period, this preconceptional period is given less importance. So this, the health of the parents in the preconceptional period, or the health of sperm and ovum in the preconceptional period, has a very important role in the health of the baby. Like if the baby goes into an age of 40 or 50, the certain researchers, latest researchers, says that the when some cardiovascular diseases or some metabolic disorders in the late 40s or in early 50s has a root cause from the preconceptional health of the parent. So that much important is the preconceptional health of the couple. So preconceptional health is the key health of the next generation. And also you can see a study published by Dr. Flamingo at Fleming in 2018. He says that he proposed certain guidelines for the couple to start, that was to to prepare in the preconceptional period. Certain guidelines has been put forward so that a healthy progeny will attain. And also you can also see new theories like the fetal basis of adult life hypothesis. That is, during the prenatal period or during the pregnancy period, if there is any insult in the nutrition, that is there is less nutrition, is there, or if there is any environmental hazard which disturbs the developmental programming, or which disturb the developmental programming of the baby, or it may cause a higher risk for the baby to develop a particular diseases or a group of diseases. So that much importance had to be given in the preconceptional period as also in this pregnancy period. Another theory on developmental origin of health and disease theory. This theory has put forward on mainly three aspects. First aspects we had discussed, the preconceptional health itself. And the second is that the intention of the couple to conceive, which is most beautifully explained in our classics, that is the psychological connection between the couple, or the intention of the couple to conceive has an effect on the health of the baby. And third thing is the diet, the lifestyle of the couple before conception, or the health, or even if some couple have like thyroid disorders or diabetes. So the health before conception has an important role in the health of the baby. That this preconceptional health, it may act through the epigenetic mechanism. It may alter the epigenetic mechanism. So what is epigenetics? Epigenetics means our diet, our behavior, our environmental factor, which can alter the expression of genes. Expression of genes means without changing the DNA, how a gene, there are so many genes, also how a gene is expressed, how the character or each normal function is established. So this gene level action can be, this epigenetics can influence the expression of single genes also. So this epigenetic action is mainly in two levels. One is at the level of germ cell development, and second is at the level of this organogenesis period. So in our classics, there are so many concepts like rajasvalacharya. So when we are doing our UGV, we really wonder, what is this rajasvalacharya? What is the relevance behind it? So this, like, during the menstruation, during the period of menstruation itself, the in the ovary we can see that the follicles, that is the new primordial follicles, start to develop. Therefore, that is for the next cycle, the new primordial follicles start to develop from the day of menstruation itself. Okay, so during this regestrella period, during this menstrual phase itself, so the for the proper like selection of the primordial follicles, for the action of FSH on this primordial follicle, this follicular growth all start during this menstrual time, previous menstrual time. So our regestrellacharya, like our concept, regestrellacharya means it explains that the psychology, that is during the menstrual period, a lady should be like the psychology, she should be pleasant and all. So our HPO axis, so if we have become pleasant and all, our HPO axis will function properly. So the HPO axis will support the growing follicles for the next cycle. So if she is planning to conceive the cycle, that definitely it will help her. And also you can see some of the diet is specified. Chaireyam, yavagam, so these are the nutritional supplement. This aim to support the nutritional requirement. And also like koshta shodhanaka, that is the abhana vadam is also given importance. Because abhana vayu has also a role in like increased ovarian blood flow, like the development of follicle, all has an indirect action of this abhana vayu. So abhana vayu is also considered, and this also this developmental follicle or the follicular phase is supported in this preconception, especially in the menstrual phase. So that may be the relevance of this rajasvalacharya. And also in Sushruta Samhita, we can see certain contraindications that these things should not be done during the menstrual period, like divasapnam, anjanam, andyam, anjanam, astrobadanam, snanam, anlevanam, nagachetanam. Like there are so many things are contraindicated. But some of the things which we can't explain, but certain things we can also consider because this astrobadana, which may be there may be a reason because of the psychological effect. Or even divasapnam, all this may affect the normal functions of vada and all. That may be the probable reason. Next, we will move on to garbhadana. Garbhadana is one among the shodasha samskara. Samskara in the sense means samskara hi gunandara adana. That is to increase the potency, to increase the quality of sperm as well as ovum. So for a healthy conception, so many factors are mentioned. Like first is age of the couple. Purna shodasha varshasti, that lady should be more than of 16 years of age. And purna vimshadena, that is the male should be more than of 20 years. 25 years in different classics it is mentioned, 20 or 25 years. So the age has an important factor. So if the age is less, then there will be the developing baby will be rogi, alpayuradanyo. It is mentioned so. So if the age is appropriate, so the speak of the maximum fertility period, if the couple is at the maximum fertility period, then the baby will be viryavandam sudha sudha. A good healthy progeny will be the output. And also in Adulya Gotriyam Adhyayam, you can also see that same gotra is contraindicated, that is with the marrying a relative or a cousin. That means that there is a risk of like if the particular family is having any like a single gene disorder, if a relative is marrying, then there is an increased risk of a single gene disorder. Especially there is more than 50% the next generation may pass on this single gene disorder. That is why same relatives is marriage between relatives is contraindicated. And also it is mentioned that this age, this gotra, and also a lady or a partner with a family history of like genetic any abnormality of any anga vaigilyam should be excluded, so that this deformity may pass to the next generation. So genetics is already understood by our acharyas. So we had discussed that if the lady is of younger age, So then there is an increased risk of neural tube defects. Neural tube defects include anencephaly, encephalosis, that spina bifida, meningomyosis. So here it is mentioned that yogi alpayu. So the baby is born with anencephaly, or then there will the baby will live only for a few days. So alpayu. So adanyu, if the baby may have such type of deformities. So it is considered that may be the probable correlation. Then if, and also here it's mentioned that in Charaka Samhita, the Adibala Adivrata, that is lady of like elderly ladies, there is an increased risk of trisomy 21 or Down syndrome. So if an elderly primate came to you with the pregnancy post, then definitely you had to screen for congenital deformity. We had to do and like neural the scanning and all, and also the double and triple marker we had to evaluate. So the factors which are responsible for a healthy progeny, like Shukra Astrak, Atma Ashe Kala Sambat, Yasya Ubajarascha Hidehi Tadanehi. So Shukra Astrak, Atma Ashe Kala Sambat. So these factors are the preconceptional factors. Yasya Ubajarascha Hidehi Tadanehi. So these are the in utero, that is during the pregnancy, the diet and lifestyle of the mother. So both these factors contribute to a healthy progeny. This Shukra and Astra, that you know that the sperm, the genetic material of the mother and father by the fusion of sperm and ovum. Atma we consider as idiopathic factor. Ashaya, that is Ashaya means Garbhashaya. Any anomaly in the Garbhashaya, so any deformity, like we can consider as any Mullerian deformity or septate uterus. Even we can consider it as a fibroid in fibroid uterus, especially the submucosal fibroid, or even a thin endometrium can be considered under this Ashaya doshas. So Kala we can consider under this, like this fertile period or fertile window or the period of ovulation, we can consider the Kala. And this Upachara of mother and diet and lifestyle of mother under the next portion. So we also know that the Garbha Sambhava, the four Garbha Sambhava Samagris, Ritu, Kshetram, Ambu and Bijam. Ritu means the fertile window, that is a period around the ovulation. Kshetram, Garbhashayam, Ambu. Here Ambu also there is some relevance. So Ambu we can consider the nutritional status, one thing we can consider. Second thing is that the proper blood supply to the uterus. Proper blood supply to the ovary. So in some cases with the premature ovarian failure or some cases, we can see that there is a reduced blood flow to the ovary. So there is a high resistance blood flow. So this Ambu, we can consider it as a proper blood supply, proper hormonal support, or we can consider under this term as Ambu. Then Bija, the male and female gametes. Another thing we had to consider is the psychological factor, Hridi or Manas. Here in Charaka Samhita reference, a beautiful quotation, Yoni Pradoshat Manaso Abhidavat Shukra Astrak Ahara Vihara Doshat Agala Yoga Bela Samshayat Garbha Chirat Vidanti Saprajabi. So that if there is any disorders in the related to the female reproductive structure, or if any psychological factors affecting the couple or the diet and lifestyle of the couple may hamper the fertility or may reduce the chance of getting pregnant. So nowadays we can see couple with more work stress, work pressure, and also we can see the diet and lifestyle, the altered diet and lifestyle, especially during the lockdown, we can see most of them sleep by around 2 p.m. Nisha Jagranam, all such light and more lifestyle changes we can see nowadays. So when these factors are affected, when this Garbha Sambhava Samagris are affected, it may cause either it can lead to infertility or it can lead to any vigridi, like any abnormality, any congenital anomaly. So for that, Bija Shuddhi is indicated. Bija Shuddhi means like a preconceptional shodhana. By this preconceptional shodhana, there is an optimal chance of this. There is a more chance of this, like the health of the sperm and ovum is improved. So, which is beautifully explained in our classics, this preconceptional shodhana. And one more thing, what I noticed is that after a preconceptional shodhana, when we are doing a follicular study, one of my friend radiologist, she told me that after our shodhana, this refractive index of this follicle is improving. That is, the quality of the follicle is improving, especially after this preconception shodhana and all. And we can advise the correcting the dinacharya, ruducharya, lifestyle modification, we can advise. And also in such couples, we had to advise them to change this, like we nowadays we can see the capsicum now, yellow, orange, what all colors it is available. So this genetically modified should be avoided, adulterated food, pesticides and all such things which alter our which alter our genetic mechanism or the genomic mechanism should be avoided. Now classics ashodhana karma is mentioned, like this after snehana, sneha swetha upadeha vamana virechanam samsho, that is after snehana and swetana vamana or virechana, if there are more dosha dushtis there, you can opt for vamana, otherwise you can opt for virechana only. And after vamana virechana, and also you can do in both in couples, and then you can do a vasti, like even a madhu tailika vasti will be good, or and after that you can give an uttara vasti also. So it in earlier practice, like my great grandfather, he used to give like sugumara grida to the couple for 45 days or for one mandala gala. It was a practice in Kerala. Every couple used to take sugumara grida for 45 days. After that, the male will take bath for 3 days. Abhyanga will be done with either danudaram tailam or even with plain coconut oil. The lady will take self abhyanga with like this plain tilatailam. After that, virechana will be done either with agavati churna or sugumara eranda. This was a common procedure. By passage of time, this our heritage, all these things had changed. So we can also, with this scientific validation, we can now validate it. With this scientific evidence, we can again bring back these precious treatment modalities or this our to our patients. And also specific diet and lifestyle is mentioned, especially diet. Like for male, Krita Kshira Abhyambusha, Krita Kshira, such type of diet is specifically mentioned for male. So the logic behind this is that this milk, grida, all contain this vitamins, calcium, zinc, selenium, etc. So these have a specific action on the male reproductive structure. Like it increases the sperm motility, it decreases the anti-sperm antibody. So there is some logic behind while this advising this Shira and Grida for male. And also for female, Tailam, Masham, Pittalam, Ahara Vidhara, like Malsyam, Kulattam, Dadi, etc. are mentioned. So these contain certain omega-3 fatty acid, iodine, calcium, zinc, etc., which regulate the hormones, which regulate the female hormones. And also it increases the blood supply. It increases the blood supply to the uterus so that ambu will be taken care of now. So it increases the blood supply and all. So there is something behind it. And also after doing a preconception shodhana, the endometrial receptivity increases. So there is an increased chance of like implantation. Okay, so after shodhana and after itravasti, there is an increased endometrial receptivity increases, and there is an increased chance of getting implanted or pregnancy. So again, the role of mind, I want to stress the role of mind. That's why I put the slide again. The manas as well as manas, like that it is mentioned. So the role of mind is there in the preconceptual period, and also during the time of sexual contact or during the time of sexual act for the conception, the role of mind is mentioned in our classic. Like at that time, the couple is either like Krudha, അന്യച്ചുപോകാൻ കാമതി, ശോകാർത്ഥം. സോ ദ സൈക്കോളജിക്കൽ ഫാക്ടർ ഓഫ് ദ കപ്പിൾ അറ്റ് ദ ടൈം ഓഫ് സെക്ഷൽ ആക്ട് ഓൾസോ ഇസ് ഇമ്പോർട്ടൻറ്റ് ഇൻ ഗെറ്റിംഗ് എ ഹെൽത്തി പ്രോജക്റ്റ്. And another thing about this mention of classic is the role of putreshtayajnam. So I would like to share one of my experience. A lady, a couple came to me. They had four abortion. So most of the abortion was done between 6 to 8 weeks. When they do a USG, heartbeat won't appear. So they had to do an abortion. After fourth abortion, they came to me. Then do this case was repeated pregnancy loss, and when I do an AMH test, her AMH level was about 0.7 nanogram per ml, and she was having diabetes mellitus. So such a complicated case was that, and after 6 or 7 months of treatment, then the lady conceived. So she was very much tense about, and the husband was also having the motility issues and all. And when the USG was done, the heartbeat was there, so the lady was very happy, and by the everything was going very well. When 16 weeks of pregnancy, the lady, her husband and her mother-in-law, they had a food poisoning. The food poisoning, and the lady was admitted in the hospital. She had edema on all over her body, and again it was forced to do an abortion because it may harm the baby. So it was forced to do an abortion. So sometimes we feel that there is something more beyond our hand. So there are certain things which is far beyond our control. So there is some role in putreshtayajna and all. So what I want to, this till now, what I want to conclude is that this, the preconceptional health of the couple had a very important role in the health of the baby, even in the late age also. So we will see from the garbha onwards. So shukra shonada jeeva samyoge, that is the fertilization of male and female gamete. So fertilization usually occur in the ambulatory portion, in the ambulatory portion of the fallopian tube. After the fertilization occurs, the fertilized ovum move towards the cavity, move towards the uterine cavity. So by after fertilization, after 30 hours of fertilization, the cells start to divide into two blastomeres. So this, by the fertilization, there is a restoration of this diploid chromosome n+n2n. There is restoration, and by 30 weeks the cells start to divide. So it starts to divide into two, that is the two blastomeres. Later, like it's the binary fission, that 2, 4, 6, like that. Then it becomes 16 cell, that is known as morula stage. After that, when it reaches to the uterine cavity, it becomes divided into two types of cell groups. One, it becomes the inner cell mass and outer cell mass. The inner cell mass develop into the embryo proper, and the outer cell mass, that is the surrounding area, the outer cell mass contribute to the development of placenta. So when it reaches by about this 8th or 9th day, it gets implanted into the endometrium. Then the endometrium becomes known as dysuria. So if there is any delay in the transport, if there is a previous history of PID or endometriosis or hydrocephalus, then there is an increased risk of implantation in the tube. So as we all know, it's known as ectopic pregnancy. So this is a brief progress of cells. This is the inner cell mass, outer cell mass. This outer cell mass or the trophoblast, it become differentiated into cytotrophoblast and syncytial trophoblast. So this cytotrophoblast and syncytial trophoblast contribute to the development of placenta. So when it attached to the uterine wall, it start to erode the blood vessels of the endometrium. We all know the spiral arterioles supply the endometrial air. So it start to erode the spiral arterioles, and the blood becomes collected into the lacunae, into the space of this cytotrophoblast and syncytial trophoblast, and thereby establishing the first uteroplacental circulation. Later by there is development of primary villi, secondary villi, and there is proper development of placenta villosa. So how we can, there is some clinical application in this chorionic villi. When the chorionic villi contains a good source of fetal DNA. So if we are doing a double markup, then if we feel that there is some congenital, there is some anomalies there. So for detailed evaluation, we can do a chorionic villi sampling. So transvaginally, a cuscus is inserted. You can see a cuscus here, and this tissue is the chorionic tissue, is a sample of this tissue is taken and can be evaluated for DNA assessment. So the placenta is well developed. Through the placenta, the maternal nutrients and oxygen, 80% saturated oxygen, is transported to the fetus. So this nutrient contribute to the garbhavruddhi. So if there is any hindrance, or if there is factor, this nutritional, the supplement is any hampered, it may lead to the IUGR or growth retardation to the baby. So in certain pregnancies which are designed to be like a hypertensive mother, that is a mother with a family history of diabetes and all, the pregnancy which is designed to be like a hypertensive, in such patients, the second wave of trophoblastic invasion is hampered. Trophoblastic invasion means at first the spiral arterioles is eroded by this trophoblastic cells, so that the blood will flow easily into the uteroplastic circulation, easily flow for the uteroplastic circulation. After that, when the baby is growing, so later the blood vessels in the myometrium, first in the endometrial layer only, second, the blood vessels in the myometrium is eroded so that more blood flow with low pressure and more low resistance, more blood flow into the uteroplastic circulation. So if the pregnancy is designed to be hypertensive, then the second wave of trophoblastic invasion is hampered, so that the hypertensive mother, the baby may be growth retarded. As you all know, fetal circulation, the blood flow from the aorta to the iliac vessel, the common iliac vessel, then to the internal iliac vessel, then to uterine artery, from the uterine artery to the spiral arteries, and then into the intervillous space. From the intervillous space, it is carried by the umbilical vein. So the umbilical vein here carry pure blood, 80% saturated with oxygen. This umbilical vein is carried by through the this umbilical cord. So this umbilical cord carry this blood. So the chordosynthesis is a procedure. Chordosynthesis, that means if we are suspecting if the baby is having any type of fetal infection, or the baby is having any type of fetal hemolytic disease. So for evaluating that, chordosynthesis can be done. Chordosynthesis means an ultrasonographically guided. You can see an US image, ultrasonographically guided. A needle is inserted through the maternal abdomen, through the uterus, and carefully a portion of this cord is punctured and blood is collected. And this 1 or 2 ml of blood is collected. And this is evaluated for any fetal infection, or if we are suspecting any thrombocytopenia and all. So the umbilical cord contains single umbilical vein and 2 umbilical arteries. So if there is any single umbilical vein is present, then there is some sort of chromosomal anomalies there. So it needs to be detailed evaluated. Another thing is amniotic fluid. So the baby is inside the amniotic cavity, which contains amniotic fluid. This amniotic fluid acts like a cushion. It supports the baby. And we can see that the fetal cells and all are present in the amniotic fluid. The amniotic fluid is mainly contributed by the covering this amniotic cavity. The amniotic cells in the covering layer contribute to the amniotic fluid, and also by the fetal transportation from the fetal circulation, and also fetal urine also contribute to this amniotic fluid. So if there are any anomalies suspected after triple or quadruple test. So amniocentesis can be done. We can utilize this amniotic fluid also because it contains the fetal cells now. So like we had chordosynthesis, we can do this amniocentesis. Amniotic fluid is collected and further evaluated for the fetal health. And also we can utilize this amniotic fluid as amniotic fluid index, AFI. This, that is, the abdomen is divided into mainly the four quadrants, and each quadrant, like the depth is measured. That is depth without the coils of this umbilical cord. Depth is measured, and the depth is like about 8 centimeter, 9 centimeter, and all. So four quadrants, four measurements is added, and if the value is less than 8, then it is considered as oligohydramnios. The fluid is less. If the value is more than 25, then it is polyhydramnios. That is, the fluid is more. So if the fluid is less, more, both had to be detailed evaluated for any anomaly or abnormality of the fetus. Next is, we will see on to the, what is the Garbhini Paricharya, the normal pregnancy period. So normal pregnancy means the baby born in term, that is like about 38 to 41 weeks. The baby weight should be more than 2.5 kilo without any maternal or fetal complication. That is a true gestation means, or the gestational period is 9 months and 7 days. So before at that time, there was no diagnostic tools like USG blood test for evaluate the beta HCG level and all. So Vekta Garbhalakshana is mentioned in our classics. Vekta Garbhalakshana means clear signs of pregnancy. So there are so many signs are mentioned. So these signs can be either in the first trimester or in the second trimester. Signs is also mentioned here. Domaraji Prakashna. Domaraji, that is the linea nigra seen in the second trimester, no? And Prasthekam, Chardi, Arojakam, all are seen in the first trimester. Murcha, and also breast changes, which are seen in the first trimester. Padashobha, which are seen in the second trimester. So these are mentioned, but these are mentioned as the clear signs of pregnancy. So we can classify or correlate these signs in our, what is mentioned in our modern era, like the nausea and vomiting, chardi, the amla kama, the craving for like amla type of taste, hyperpigmentation, linea nigra, pedal edema, all we can correlate. Now we will see what are the common subjective symptoms which a lady complained to you, or which a lady will tell. First, definitely will be amenorrhea, absence of menstruation. In the first trimester, definitely there will be morning sickness, nausea and morning sickness. It usually lasts for only 12 weeks. After 12 weeks, definitely it will subside. Or if a lady is having severe vomiting, then hyperemesis, gravidarum, it should be taken proper care of. Then frequency of maturation. As we all know, the uterus is antevertebral. That is, the uterus rests on the top of the bladder. So if the baby is growing, it may cause compression to the bladder. So this compression to the bladder may cause, like the lady may have feel that increased frequency. The bladder is full, like that the lady may feel. So there is an increased frequency of maturation, and also breast changes the lady will note, and she may have fatigue. These are the common signs or subjective symptoms that a lady will complain. The signs mean, when we are doing an examination, especially the first trimester, we can see the signs like Jacquemus sign. Jacquemus sign means bluish discoloration in the vaginal area. And Osiander sign, increased pulsation as a result of increased blood flow to the genital tract. These are the common signs which we can see in the first trimester. In the second trimester, the lady may tell you about the quickening, or the movements of the baby can be perceived in the second trimester. And also there is a progressive enlargement of the abdomen, pigmentation on the face, linea nigra, stria start to appear. All these are the common findings in the second trimester. In the third trimester, again, the lady may complain that heaviness in the abdomen because the baby is fully grown. So, and also there is a pressure like symptoms, pedal edema, and common symptoms that again, frequency of maturation reappear. more fetal movements will be perceived by the mother. These are the common symptoms in the third trimester. So in the first trimester, before 12 weeks, the uterus become only a pelvic organ. After 12 weeks, then only the uterus become an abdominal organ. After 12 weeks, it becomes a suprapubic bulge. This is the pubic symphysis, the suprapubic bulge after 12 weeks. Then by 24 weeks, it reaches around the abdomen. So we can easily palpate and we can easily understand the week of gestation. So there are so many physiological changes are seen during the pregnancy period. So these physiological changes are mainly to adjust like the for the or also to meet the needs of the developing baby, and also to meet the nutritional requirement, to give more space to the baby to grow. So these are the common some of the every system is having a change in the pregnancy. Say it about the uterus and genitourinary system, also gastrointestinal system, cardiovascular, there is hemodilution and all. So every system is undergoing a normal physiological change during the pregnancy. So as a result of this normal physiological changes, the lady may experience some of the certain minor ailments in her pregnancy. Some of the common symptoms like a nausea, vomiting, heartburn, constipation and hemorrhoids, especially around the last trimester, back pain as a result of this bulge in the bulge, and also this posture change, muscle cramping, pedal edema. So the minor elements had to be evaluated. The minor elements is not a minor concern for a pregnant lady. So we had to take care of her discomfort. Hello, doctor. Am I audible?
Yes, doctor, you're audible. Yes.
Okay. So the importance of antenatal care is that we had to screen for every pregnancy. We had to screen for a high risk case. So we had to screen, and if the lady may be a hypertensive or diabetic, or she may have a thyroid related issues, or there may be an increased risk of preeclampsia during the pregnancy. So every pregnancy we had to screen, and we had to screen for high risk case if we are detect any any discomfort or like anything. We had to give proper care and attention to that lady. And also we had to advise we had to make like educate the lady the normal physiological changes in the pregnancy. And the diet of the mother is very important, mainly to the support the nutritional requirement, and also to meet the macro demand of this macro as well as micronutrients. All these things had to be taken care of. And also in India, only 32% of women will attain that. There should be an increased weight of minimum 11 kilos. So the this needed weight gain is only maintained by the 32% of population only. So some of the populations are below the weight gain. So the health, the nutritional requirement of the mother has a very important role in the health of the baby. So that thing should be taken care of. So the preconception health and also the in utero life of the baby has a very good impact on the health of the baby. So Garbhini Paricharya, what is mentioned in our class 6, is the optimal intrauterine conditioning of the developing fetus to support this physiological need, support this physiological nutritional need, and also to support the physiological changes like the pedal edema and all. We usually advise like 6 month Gokshira Siddham Paya, we advise. So to support the physiological changes, to meet the nutritional demand, and also to support a normal delivery. So that is the main aim of the Garbhini Paricharya. So every area is covered in our classes. Like we can see here the like about the psychological factor. During the pregnant lady had to be like psychologically calm and peace and happy. Remain, she should remain happy, like Shanti Magala. That is to mainly to pamper her, to comfort her and to reduce her like this pregnancy related ailments. And also you can see here this Malina Vigrata Heena Gatrani Na Sparshi. So to prevent the possible chance of infection to the pregnant lady, these things are advised. So nowadays COVID also, and also the torch infection, and all these things should be prevented affected from getting affected by the pregnant lady. Her diet, her lifestyle, everything is given importance in our classes. And also Manidharana is mentioned, her about her diet. She should take bath daily, she should wear clean clothes, and also she should bath vadahara patra siddhantoyam, likes her from her diet, lifestyle, her bathing, her, every aspect is considered. And also garbhasthavana drugs is mentioned. Garbhasthavana like drugs like Aidri, Brahmisha, Davidya, Sahasravidya, Amoga, Avyada. So many garbhasthavana drugs are mentioned. So if in the early pregnancy, if there is a spotting or if there's an increased risk of threatened abortion means there is an chance for the to continuing of pregnancy. There's an increased chance for continuing pregnancy. So if we take proper care of, then there is a 80% chance of continuing pregnancy in a threatened abortion. So we usually give the garbhasthavana drugs, or some of the drugs mentioned in Pumsavana also have this garbhasthavana action. And also our bala sarpas, which is also usually give for, like it has a progesterone like action. We can give like a progesterone supplement, we can give bala sarpas. And if we are giving bala sarpas along with the progesterone tablet, then there is an increased risk of constipation to the lady. So if you are giving bala sarpas, if you are giving this progesterone, if the lady is taking progesterone, then bala sarpas should be given in a only minimal quantity only. Otherwise, we can give this bala sarpas as a progesteronic supplement. So we had this abortion. There is an before the termination, before the period of viability is considered abortion. It can be threatened or inevitable abortion or even missed abortion. So we can manage threatened abortion more easily. Another concept mentioned about the maternal and fetal metabolic communication. That is the, as pregnancy is an, like an anabolic stage, that is more nutrients is needed. So this nutrient requirement is properly maintained. We can also consider the our concept Dauhrda and this maternal and nutritional communication. We can consider it under this concept. So every month, the Masanamasika Vritti, the Vritti of the baby is mentioned. Like in first month, Kalalavasta. Second month, Pindaha Peshi Adava Arbudam. Arbudam, I think what is intended by Arbudam is the like hydrated form of pregnancy. That thing like we can construct under the Arbuda. Then third month, Gatra Panchakam. Fourth month, Tiratama Batide, Mamsa Shonta Bajam, fifth month, Belavarna Bajam, sixth month, Anavastita Ojas. Anavastita Ojas is mentioned in eighth month. So Anavastita Ojas, what I feel is that before 34 weeks, there is reduced surfactants is produced in the fetal line. So if a fetus is born before that, there is increased the chance of like fetal breathing difficulty. So only after this 36 weeks, only this fetal lungs, the surfactants will be properly produced and fetal lungs will be properly functioning. So nowadays corticosteroid therapy is done if the baby is born before like 36 weeks. So at that time, due to this lack of surfactants, it is mentioned that the anavastita ojas. Next is Masanamasika Paricharya. So every month, depending upon the condition, that is in the first month, it is given more of like sweet liquid diet because of this vomiting and all, like easily absorbable type of food is mentioned. And you can see in the sixth month, Petaladima Gokshira, that is mild diuretic is mentioned. And eighth month, if most of the ladies may have constipation and all, so this enema is mentioned. And if like Yoni Piju is mentioned by the time of the delivery and all, which relaxes the vaginal orifice. And also like in the ninth month and all, especially after 8 months, I usually used to give Sugumaram Gritam. Sugumara Grutam has a like action of like Sugaprasava Grita, and also Sugumara Grita can be given. What I notice is that if we are giving Sugumara Grita in the late trimester, especially after 8 months, there is an increased like FS receptor action. That is, there is more receptor action even with the mild pitocin, that the contraction of uterus is more. It is explained to me by one of my senior gynecologist doctor, Dr. Jayasri. She told me that if ladies who take this Sugumara Gruda, they have the with less amount of pitocin, they have more good contraction. Then Masana Masya Shira Kashaya is mostly followed in, especially from Sastava, is mostly followed in Kerala. And this Bella in first month, Lakshmana in the second month. And in some doctors here give like this Bella, Kurundoti Palkashan from 7th month onwards. So a specific diet and lifestyle is mentioned. And do's and don'ts also is mentioned, especially by this Garbha Upakadakara Bhavas. Like for example, like Uttana Shayanam is mentioned, that is lying straight as contraindicated. Or left lateral position is more indicated because it supports the more uteroplasmic circulation, and also it reduces like this heartburn and all. So, and also this heartburn, gastric irritation and all. So Uttana Shayanam is contraindicated, and also Adi Vivayam, Ayasam and all, especially Agala Jagarnam, Psychology, Shogam, Krodham, all are contraindicated. So the mind of the mother has a very good role. If the husband is very caring and all, the mother will feel happy, and that happiness will be reflected to the baby, the health of the baby also. And one of a study done by one of my senior Dr. Deepthi, you can Google it, you can easily search it. She had done her work on like the music therapy in pregnancy, which has a very good result, the music for the health of the baby. And yoga in pregnancy, if the lady is not having any threatened abortion, or if she had not done any no history of the cervical incompetence or placenta previa and all, she can practice yoga under the guidance of a doctor. Every month, like in first trimester, second, different yogas are mentioned. If not possible, just sitting straight in a chair, like holding the abdomen, and just simply like listening to the breath itself is a yoga, itself is a sukhasana. Now we will see what are the complications in pregnancy. So that is one of the main complications, which is the garbha poshana. There is some defect in the proper garbha poshana. So there is some defect in the vriddhi also. In the early times, that is before the developing of the placenta, especially during the transportation from the fallopian tube to the cavity, the mainly the secretions, the glycogen secretion from the endometrium contribute to the development of the fertilized ovum. After the development of the placenta, it is completely under the placental circulation. So if there is any defect, it may lead to IUGR. We already discussed that. Which is mentioned in our classics like Upavishtakam, Nagotaram, Garbhakshayam, Leena Garbhana. So some of the common IUG, common causes for intrauterine growth retardation is like poor nutritional intake or poor weight gain or undernutrition, anemia, hypertension, or other common maternal cause for intrauterine growth retardation. Some of the fetal causes like structural anomaly, chromosomal anomaly, or infection, which are the common fetal causes for IUGR. And placenta, like placental factors like placenta previa, circumvallate placenta, or they also contribute to the IUGR. So if there is I already mentioned the Vada has a main role, the Garbha Vriddhi. So if the diet is like a Vada Koba type of diet, then it may cause like pitta sleshma. It may cause pitta sleshma along with the pitta and sleshma. It causes constriction to the rasavaha nadi, thereby hampering the nutrition to the baby. And it may lead to this like IUGR or intrauterine growth retardation. So if the baby, like this is the blood flow, uteroplacental insufficiency, the blood flow is less. So then what happens is that the more oxygen needed portions of the baby's body, like brain, heart, adrenal, etc. So this blood will be more given more importance. The oxygen which is come from the mother is given more importance to these organs only. This is known as the brain sparing effect. This is a certain remodeling of course in the baby circulation. So this brain sparing effect, that is the major portion of the, that is brain, heart and adrenal get the important organs are supplied more oxygen. Other organs will get only less supply. So this is known as the brain sparing effect. So this reprogramming, even though this reprogramming is temporary, but this reprogramming has an effect on the this child's future health also. So if there is an IUGR or if there is a any polygo or polyhedronous, always exclude any congenital anomaly. So if one anomaly is found, then also check for further anomalies. So there may be a risk for multiple anomalies. So all should be evaluated properly. And rest should be taken in the left lateral position to increase more uteroplasmic circulation. If the nutrition is less, it should be this corrected. If BP is more, then it should be the BP medicine should be given and the BP should be under control. And fetal health should be evaluated. And the some of the deadly triads in pregnancy is considered. One is hypertension, one is infection, and one is hemorrhage. These are the deadly triads. It may affect the mother and also it may affect the baby also. So hypertension means this gestational hypertension means the hypertension in pregnancy. That is the BP, if there is an increase in BP after 20 weeks of pregnancy. So up to 20 weeks, the BP was normal. After 20 weeks, only there is increase with more than 140, 90 nanomillimeters of Hg. So before that, the BP was normal. That is gestational hypertension. Chronic hypertension means the lady was hypertensive before pregnancy also. That is chronic hypertension. In gestational hypertension, there's an increased risk of developing preeclampsia. Preeclampsia in the sense means increased BP along with protein, urea, along with complication. And eclampsia means this preeclampsia, that is increased BP, protein, urea, and certain disorders from the liver. And also this convulsion and coma, which is more common around the last trimester or even during the labor. So diabetes mellitus means gestational diabetes is more common. That is the in pregnancy is like an anabolic stage. No, there is more glucose is needed. So as a result of this pregnancy changes, there is like the pancreas, the islets of Langerhans, especially beta cells in the islets of Langerhans, they undergo hypertrophy and hyperplasia. So that more insulin is produced. It's the pregnancy state of hyperinsulinemia. More insulin is produced and also the body is having like insulin resistance is there. So there is insulin resistance is there. But in normal pregnancy, this insulin resistance can be overcome by the body. But in certain patients, in certain subjects, this insulin resistance cannot be overcome and they are considered as a gestational diabetes. So if women with PCOS or with the family history of diabetes, definitely there will be an increased risk of gestational diabetes mellitus, especially after 24 weeks. So if the lady is having diabetes before pregnancy, then it may affect the organogenesis also. They affect the organogenesis of the baby also. But after the organogenesis period, especially after 24 weeks, gestational diabetes mellitus, it may not cause any organogenesis or like any genetic abnormality, but it may cause like macrosomia, pregnancy complication, and all. Intrauterine death may be a complication. Next is hemorrhage. Hemorrhage is one of the complications in it can be either due to the placental cause, usually placenta previa or abrupto detachment of the placenta, especially after 22 weeks of pregnancy. So now we will move on to the postnatal care. The postnatal care is mainly aimed to correct the acne, to bring about vada and lomana, garbhashaya shodhana, sthanyajanna, vedana stam. These are the main aim. So generally, we usually first the acne should be considered. So for first 3 days, Panchakula Churnam or even Ashtachurna can be given along with light, easily digestible food. After the fifth day onwards, we can give like Shodhana type of medicine, and Dashamudha Arishtam, Jigiraka Arishtam, Abhay Arishtam, in the combination we can give. These are the general line of treatment. But depending upon the condition of the Sudhika, we can change the medicines. And Puling Goemba can be given 1 teaspoon along with either with like Pachamuri, you know, diluted and curd and all. You can give one along with 1 teaspoon. After 13th day, you can give Dhanudram Kashayam, 4 teaspoon Kashayam with 25 ml of water along with Dhanudram Guliga, Avarti, you can give. And also after the this kashaya routine and all, you can give like grida for brahmana. Like usually we can, if the lady is obese and all, if the for the proper like immunity of the baby, we can give Induganta Purta also, Dadi Madi Gridam, Chavana Prasham, Tingam Bukala Lehim, depending upon the subject, depending upon the condition of the mother as well as baby, we can choose the medicines, we can alter. This is a general samanya, like a general protocol only. Next is this patya should be maintained for 45 days. Agni should be correct. We should evaluate the agni. And all then abhyangam with the dhanudram thailam. Then like snanam with like warm water or vadahara patra and all. And ensure whether lactation is done properly. Advise contraception for 2 years. And exercise can be advised after 45 days. If cesarean is there after, you can advise after 60 days, exercise can be started. So here ends our introduction to this lecture session. Thank you all for your patient listening.
Thank you, ma'am. That was a wonderful session.
Thank you, doctor.
That was a great introduction to our Raksha program that is going to happen on 23rd. So, ma'am, we have a few questions. Okay. Can you answer them?
Yes, sure.
So the first question is, can you explain about Sugumara Grita that is given for 1 mandala kala? And what is the dosage of Sugumara Grita?
Okay. For preconceptionally, we can give Sugumara like 10 ml we can give. If you're giving twice a daily, you can give 10 ml or even 5 ml. If 5 ml also, you can 5 to 10 ml depending upon the acne. First, you had to evaluate the acne. Then give Sugumara Grita for 5 to 10 ml twice daily for 45 days. After that, Virejana should be done. That also you had to take care of.
Okay, ma'am. So after the 1 mandala kala administration of Sugumara Grita, we have to go for Virejana.
Yes.
Okay. Ma'am, Dr. Shubha Swati is asking, can you explain about the Sugumara Grita and Bala Sarpis?
Both. Okay, so, this concept was actually put forward by my teacher Vijay Kumar sir. He gave this medicines in like Sugumara Grita is having like an estrogenic action and Balasarpas is having a progesteronic action. This we by later our practice we really felt so. If we're giving Sugumara Grita to an endometriotic patient, so endometriosis patient in which if the exogenous estrogen will give, then definitely the endometrial cyst will grow. So if you give Sugumara Grita to an endometriotic patient, definitely will harm. It won't do any good. So the Sugumara has having an estrogenic property. So this we can give in the initial phase, especially after that is in the follicular phase. In the follicular phase, if it's a normal subject without endometriosis, you can give Sugumara Grita like in the supporting the proliferation of the follicle. This has a very good effect. So in cases with diminishing ovarian reserve, I had given the Sugumara Grita. It has very good effect. Sugumara Grita with Shatapushpa Charna Shurna has a very good effect on that. And it also supports the good follicle, good quality of the follicle. Okay. And then Balasarpas we can give after ovulation. It has a progesteronic type of action. So Balasarpas has a Garbhasthapana property also. It supports the like secretory endometry also. So in implantation defect type of patient, we can give this Balasarpas, which has a very good role. And also in the pregnancy for the first 2 months also, you can give this Sugumara Grita for this Garbhasthapana property.
Okay. Thank you. So next we have a question from Kala. She's asking that Shushruta says Romaraji Abhyubhagar as a sign of early pregnancy. Any information regarding this?
I had mentioned that it is like a Vekta Garbalakshana. It is like signs of pregnancy. That early days, we know that Romaraji, that is Lina Nigra, is seen in the second trimester only. So these are Vekta Garbalakshana or the definite signs of pregnancy. So Romaraji is seen only in pregnancy. I don't know any other condition with Romaraji. So these are not signs which is seen the first trimester. You can see Padashobha also, which is seen only by the sixth month and all. So these are the definite signs, not Vekta Garbalakshana. We can consider it as a definite signs of pregnancy more than the first trimester signs.
Okay. So there is another question. What's the alternative for milk if the mother is lactose intolerant?
Doctor, can you explain it once more? I didn't get you.
What is the alternative for milk if the mother is lactose intolerant?
Hello?
Hello, ma'am.
Yes.
Okay. What's the alternative for milk if the mother is lactose intolerant?
Lactose intolerance. Lactose intolerance of mother. Is it my voice?
Ma'am, your voice is proper, ma'am.
Okay. If the mother is lactose intolerant, then you can opt for like what I usually give, like dilute milk only. Not that much, like a small quantity of milk more diluted in water. That is usually I used to give, but it won't do any harm. Other alternative, actually, I don't know. Sorry, doctor.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, another question. When we are administrating Bhalasarpis, both during the pregnancy and as a preconceptional care, so how will be the quantity? How can we decide the quantity or how should we administer it?
So, doctor, is it for like preconception Sneha Pana, like Achapana.
Conceptional as Achapana.
Achapana, we will start usually anything we will start after correcting that thing, after giving Ashtachurna or Kashayas and all. After correcting the acne, we should start from 25 if we are planning to do an Achapana. After starting from 25, 50, like that, we can give for 7 days. Otherwise, if you have during lockdown times, I had to give patients at home. So I usually give 10 or 15 ml twice daily for 5 to 7 days and do Amrita Shodhana. That also we can do according to our situation.
Okay, ma'am. And when we are administrating Bhalasarpis, can we administer a Bhalasarpis during the pregnancy time?
Usually I used to give during first 3 months. I used to give in my precious pregnancy patients. I usually give Bhalasarpis for first 3 months.
So how will be the dosage, madam?
I usually give 5 ml twice daily.
Okay.
And also I usually give Profertef, which is also one of my favorite patent medicine. Okay. I usually give this for the first trimester.
Okay. Another question, ma'am. What should be the dosage of Bhalasarpis if the patient is taking progesterone?
If the patient is taking progesterone, then I usually give 5 ml only in the early morning. If the lady is taking progesterone at night, or otherwise if she is taking the progesterone the early morning, I usually give Bhalasarpis at night. Like that, depending upon. And if we usually ask the patient if she is having any like of increased nausea or vomiting or constipation, that also we had to evaluate.
Ma'am, how to manage torch infection?
Torch infection, actually, we had to, in the next pregnancy, we had to do a Shodhana. And all before getting conceived, Bhalasarpis also has a very good, one of the study is doing in Trivandrum Government Ayurveda College on this repeated pregnancy loss with Bhalasarpis. This study was going good. And also we can give, during the preconception period, Viluadi Guli and all, we can give to, we can also plan a Shodhana also to correct it, and Panchatikta, Mahatiktakam type of medicines, or even this Sharibadi Asam all can be given. Sure, to like a pitta shamana we had to do before conception.
Okay.
Shodhana is very important for repeated pregnancy loss.
Ma'am, there is a question that just before pregnancy, just before the couple is ready to conceive, what are the diet plans that they should adopt?
That we had covered, no? Before this conception, we had to stick on to healthier diet, like folic acid rich diet. We had mentioned the omega 9 rich fish and all a lady should take to improve the endometrial receptivity and all. And also try to avoid junk food, fast food, and depending upon the condition, if the lady is having a fist of PCOS, we had to plan it accordingly. And also if the male is having like smoking alcohol, some type of habit, we had to advise them to stop all those things and advise the male to, they are taking like more non-veg and all. And that thing had to be stopped. We had to detailly take the history of their diet and lifestyle, what all things they take. We had to evaluate it. Then we can advise what we feel that this that is not appropriate should be excluded from their diet and lifestyle.
Okay, ma'am. And just as it is described in Ashtanga Hridaya, like the lady can take black tila and male can take masha. That can also be advised, madam.
Yes, definitely. If this tila is having this artava janaka property also. So what I notice is that if a pregnant lady, one of my patients, she's having irregular cycles. So I had given her Saptasaram, Hinkojadi, Kumariasman and all. She's having irregular cycles. For that, I usually give these medicines. So even after the expected date, if she's not getting periods, I advise her to take this tilam, black tilam, along with this 2 teaspoon of this coconut scraping, along with hingu and gudam, black gudam. I advise her to take that for 1 or 2 days, for like 2 or 3 ball of that. Then she will get periods. So after 2 or 3 cycles, on the 4th cycle, she told me that even after taking this guda and all, this tila guda combination and hingu and all, she didn't get her periods. I'm taking this for 4 or 5 days, doctor. I have taken this 4 or 5 balls. So I have to advise her to do a UPT test. Her UPT was pregnant positive. And even this black tila, it's an artava janaka, but it won't cause any harm to the pregnancy. The pregnancy was uneventful and all.
Okay. There's another question, ma'am. What should be the Grida selection for endometriosis? I think she has told it as endometriotic cyst.
Endometriotic cyst. I usually give in endometriotic cyst. My favorite combination is Mahatiktakam. Mahatiktakam Gridam or Mahatiktakam Kashayam. This Gurujyadi, as I usually give Gurujyadi as Toyam, which has very good effect. Then I usually give Sharivadi Asam. Even with this combination, or if she's having heavy bleeding, Trayandhyadi Kashayam is also included. So with this combination, I had even endometriotic cyst of 3 centimeters had disappeared. So this is a very good effect. This Mahatiktaka, Gurujyadi Kashayam, if she's of light of Kaba Prakriti, you can also give Kubbilatiktaka Kashayam also. Depending upon her condition, you can opt this Pitta Shamana, Shamaka type of drugs.
Ma'am, there is a question from Sapna. She's asking that can Balasarpis and Sukumara Grida given together after conceiving during the pregnancy?
No, actually. Sukumara Grida is having some Aranda preparation. Aranda is there. So it won't be good to after, especially in the initial trimester. In the initial trimester, Balasarpis is good. In the late trimester, this Sukumara, especially after 8th month, the Sukumara is good.
Okay. Ma'am, after Grita, as you had mentioned about the Mandala Kala, the Grita intake during the Mandala Kala, what can be the Mrudu Virechana that can be given and what is the dose?
You can give Sukumara Aranda or even Avibhakti also. Sukumara Aranda you can give, or Hingu Trigona Thaila also you can give 5 to 10 ml. If the ladies having or male is having Amrit Koshta, then this Hingutrigona or Sugumara Tala 5 to 10 ml will only cause purgation for 3 or 4 times.
Okay.
Also, you can give Avipati Churna. If it's Amrit Koshta, even if 5 gram Avipati can be cause like a huge purgation. In a Krura Koshta, even 10 milligram or 10 gram won't cause any result. So depending upon the Koshta only.
Ma'am, what is the alternative for iron and calcium tablet in Ayurveda, which is taken during the pregnancy period?
You can give Mandura Vadaga. You can give. It's a very good combination. Mandura Vadaga, you can give in pregnancy.
And for calcium also the same?
Shankabasmam, I usually don't give calcium Ayurvedic supplement. Shankabasma, I have heard my seniors have given Shankabasma, but I have not given alternative for calcium supplement. Only iron supplement I usually give.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, how Panchakarma will be helpful in adenomyosis as well as in PCOD?
Both are different aspects. In PCOD, if it's obese PCOD, we had to do like Vamana, Panchakarma, especially Vamana. There is more Kama Dushti there. Kama Shamana is the main line. So in adenomyosis and all, we had to do like more of Vada Pitta Shamana is the first line that we had to like keep in mind.
There is a question that the Ayurvedic medication that can cure PCOD.
There is no single remedy, but we can, if the Kanashadahuadi, like Saptasaram, Kumariyasam, Punarnavasam, all can reduce the ovarian volume. And first thing, diet and lifestyle modification is must. If the weight is, if the lady obese PCOS is there, if she's reducing the weight, definitely our medicine will be more potent. It will act more easily. If the ovarian volume reduces, then cycles will automatically be regular.
Ma'am, there is a question. What all medicines do you usually prescribe for a normal pregnant lady from the first month till the 9th month, if it, in a normal condition?
Like what I had mentioned in Sahasra Yoga, that is the common medicine preparation that I usually advise. Or in the first times, I usually give this Balasarpas and all, or even Dadimadi, if she's having vomiting and all, Dadimadi Gritham and all, that I usually advise. And depending upon the condition only, if she is having any like symptoms and all, then we will enter the medicine. Otherwise, I'll stick on this Sahasra Yoga, especially. And some patients, if they are not ready to take this Shirakashaya every month, so from 7th month, I will add Bela Shirakashaya to them. And also in the last month, I usually give this Sugumara. This has some my favorite choice.
Okay. Ma'am, also, if there is like in pre-eclampsia or eclampsia conditions, what all medications that we can advise?
Doctor, I had not managed the pre-eclampsia type of condition, but I had managed both a mild increase in BP and all, but not managed pre-eclampsia type of patient.
So, ma'am, can we prescribe our own Ayurvedic medications?
I think that Dr. Wahida Rahman, she is managing complicated pregnancy, and she will give you a very good lecture on it.
Okay, thank you. Ma'am, how to reduce weight after 6 months of delivery? Like, she's asking about the medications that we can give to reduce weight.
If she's feeding, breastfeeding, then medications won't, kindly don't give any medications, because it may affect the baby also. You can start a mild exercise on it. That will be a best choice. Don't take any medicines to reduce weight.
Okay. Ma'am, there are two questions regarding PCOD. How can we manage PCOD with a normal weight as well as with a lean PCOD?
Normal weight. Yes. If the cycles is in a lean PCOS, we can see more of like androgen insensitivity. Like that, we can notice like more like hyperandrogenism. There is some alteration hormones is the first thing we will notice. So we had to correct that. We had to correct Panchatiktagam, Mahamanjishtadi, Sharivadiyasam. That medicines will correct the hormone level. And then we can manage. Then we do look the ovarian volume. Ovarian volume is one of the main criteria that how our medicine will act. So depending up, usually you should recheck the ovarian volume, whether our medicine is acting, the cycle, if the cycles are getting regular, that's a good sign. And second thing, we had to like check the ovarian volume. It should get back into normal. Then the cycle will like regular, will that that will continuously like will be regular. But if we stop medicine without checking the ovarian volume, then even after stopping medicine, one or two cycles will be normal. Otherwise, it won't. Again, it will be turned back into the previous condition.
Ma'am, how can we manage asrigdhara? As well as there is a question related to that. How can we treat DUB with menorrhagia?
Okay. If during the bleeding phase, you can give the musalikadradi kashayam, pushyanakam churnam, trayandiyadi kashayam. If there is fibroids there, you can give trayandiyadi, have more good effect. So after bleeding is stopped, in between the cycles, that is the period, that's a crucial period. We had to give more medicine for to prevent the next cycle from getting heavy bleeding. Usually give mahatiktagam, like pitta chamana type of medicine. Mahatiktagam, drakshadi kashayam, like gobi chandanadi guliya, all have the specific action which reduces the next cycle. And also check the endometrial thickness also. So if endometrial thickness is more, some lagana type of medicine will also have particular effect. If for the patient usually come and also advise the patient to come to you if the bleeding is, even after 3 or 4 days, if the patient feels that the bleeding is more, then advise the patient to come to you and start to take medicine. Otherwise, the patient will wait for 7 or 8 days, then their HP will fall down. After that, then only they came. So it's like a constant touch with DUB patients. You have to evaluate them regularly.
Okay. Ma'am, also, how can we manage hyperprolactinemia?
Hyperprolactinemia, what I got is the result one case with the trayandiyadi and kanjanara gupulu and drakshadi kashayam. I got very good effect in this hyperprolactinemia case.
Almost pitta shamana treatment.
Yes. Kanjanara guru, that is some like grindy type of avastha. That kanjanara also very good effect. So also check the thyroid level also.
Okay.
If thyroid is altered, then there will be an, a cause of hyperprolactinemia. So thyroid should be evaluated along with, you can give these medicine also.
Okay. Ma'am, I guess all the questions you have answered that has come in the chat box.
Thank you all for your patient listening.
So we'll wind up today's session, madam. First of all, I thank Dr. Divya, madam, for explaining us to us all about all the aspects like that will be dealt in the raksha. But before entering into raksha, you have given a very beautiful introduction. So I guess our listeners will be very much enlightened with this. Thank you so much, madam.
Thank you all.
And I thank all the participants for participating in our introductory class. And for more information, you can contact Ayurveda Map.